So it's my very great pleasure to welcome you to the Antipode lecture on co-producing knowledges of the city. My name is Jenny Pickrell, and I'm part of the Antipode Journal editorial collective. As you know, Antipode is a radical journal of geography, and it's long been its mission to encourage critical analysis of contemporary problems. Doing this requires an understanding of how and why we are where we are, how problems come into existence, and therefore we need both a historical perspective and exploration of innovative ways forward. Here today we have two great people who've been providing the tools to do just this. We're very pleased to host a lecture today with Queen Mary University of London professors Gareth Stedman-Jones and Jane Wills. A professor of the history of ideas, Gareth has a particular interest in the political thought and economics of the 19th century. He's recently republished Outcast London, a study in the relationship between classes in Victorian society, examines representations of the city produced by politicians, religious leaders, novelists, and social investigators, looking at the uncertainty and volatility of the working class lives subject to the world economy, and explores their relation to charitable institutions and the welfare state. Professor Stedman-Jones founded the History Workshop Journal and spent many years at Cambridge University. He's published over 5 books and countless articles. He's a fellow of the British Academy and has had his work featured in radio and television programmes. A professor of human geography, Jane's research on labour politics, in-work poverty and migrant workers, and community organisation and the Living Wage Campaign looks at, and indeed participates in, representations of contemporary London injustices and inequalities, struggling to interpret and change a place perhaps not so different from its past. Jane has an enduring interest in low-wage labour in London and the need for a living wage. Her involvement with Citizens UK and the Living Wage Campaign in particular has been widely cited in television, radio and press coverage worldwide. Jane has published over 7 books and is a previous editor of Antipode. We're going to have a talk where both Gareth and Jane talk together, and then we'll have time for questions at the end. So please join me in welcoming Gareth and Jane here today.
Thanks to Jenny and all of you for coming. It's great to spend time with a colleague from a different department at Queen Mary. So Gareth's in history and I'm in geography, and this has been a time for us to spend time together, which has been great. What we're proposing to do is talk about 2 different historical periods, Gareth from the 1880s to about World War I, and me from the 1980s to the present, 2 very different periods, looking at 2 bodies of research work, one Gareth's reissued book, Outcast London, and Global Cities at Work, New Migrant Divisions of Labour, which I'm going to talk about later on, which was actually a project with colleagues at Queen Mary, Kathy McElwain, Kavita Datta, John May, Yara Evans and Joanna Herbert. And so I need to acknowledge them up front because there won't be time when we're rushing through later on. We want to talk about these 2 periods in one place, highlighting the key similarities and differences in the labour market and the effects of the labour market on life in East London and London more generally, and the politics that emerge as a response to that. And our penultimate piece is going to be about how we came to think about these things, so what kind of ideas we used when making sense of these labour markets in different historical periods. And then we hope there'll be time for plenty of discussion. So that's the plan, a talk in 3 parts. And I'll hand over to Gareth now, who's going to talk about the period of Outcast London.
Yes, I think what brings us together is a disturbing sense of obvious difference, but also similarities between what we face looking at London today and what I studied when I studied Victorian London and the problem of casual labour as it was seen in Victorian London between the 1840s and 1914. And that's the first picture. I hope it's clear enough for everyone to see it. What it portrays is the building of the docks in 1860. And one of the problems about building the docks is that they built too many of them. There was an oversupply of docks, But that, together with that, went a captive supply of labour. So the obvious thing to do was to casualise the system. And here we are. Yes, the slide on the left, it's not as large as it should be, but what it's really showing is that what develops from the 1850s onwards is a system of people crowding at the dockyard gates, and then some sort of foreman comes along and picks the people who are going to do the labour. And usually they made a point of not choosing the same person too often, because they wanted to keep the supply as full as possible. And that's the misery that is created at the dockyard gates and becomes a typical representation of poverty in Victorian London. What I did in the book was to look not just at the docks as forms of casual labour, but to look at the London economy as a whole. Because of the very high rents, London wasn't a place where you tended to find factories, except later towards the Edwardian period in places like Woolwich and so on. But in inner London, what you had was high rent, small workshops, or the ultimate way to save rent was to have homework. And that's what you get. On the other hand, you do get some development of factory workshop work. And the picture on the right is a picture of workmen's trains. From the 1860s onwards, they developed special trains for workmen going at special hours, and these become very important in developing particularly north-eastern London, where these new train services went. Now we come to something which Jane will have more to say about than I do, but this is one of the accompaniments of male casual labour, and that is mainly the so-called sweating of female labour. In this case, you can't see what gender these people are because they're portrayed as skeletons. Sweated labour was a very widespread phenomenon, particularly in east and northeastern central London. And what it creates is something which reinforces the sense of a captive labour market. If I can just read one little paragraph from the original book. Yes. The casual labourer, if married, found himself trapped in a vicious circle. For casual labour virtually necessitated family work in order to attain a bearable level of subsistence. But on the other hand, family work, which was normally of an unskilled kind, redoubled the immobility of the casual labourer. For the uncertain gamble of obtaining more regular work elsewhere entailed not only risking his own livelihood, but also that of his wife or partner. Moreover, it was precisely in areas dominated by casual labour that suitable unskilled female employment was most likely to be found. So the two things go very much together in the Victorian and Edwardian periods. What I also studied in the book was, as it were, the ways in which the vast amount of labour in Victorian London was seasonal, and these trades, ideally, economists of the period hoped they would dovetail one period from another. Building trades, of course, were classically things which go soft in the winter, but then come back in the spring and the summer. So then you've got to find other work in winter. And very often you get phenomena not so much of cyclical unemployment, but seasonal unemployment, particularly in the cold months of January and February. And one of the things that are then laid on are the Victorian stone yard. If you couldn't get work anywhere else, particularly in these harsh winter months, you had various unpleasant bits of work to do, breaking stone or, of course, don't forget, this is a period of sailing ships and so on, so the ropes, which are held together by oakum, you have to pick oakum, which I gather is also a very unpleasant job, and it was very much something which went on in the East End. Of course, this concentration also produces produces problems about housing, and those problems about housing get worse between the 1860s and the 1880s or 90s. There is, of course, quite a lot of philanthropic housing which is built. You can still see it if you go on the train from Liverpool Street out to Cambridge, the Waterloo buildings. I don't think you can still see the inscription, but they're still there, the same buildings as before. They were vast. Anyway, here's a... Yes, that sort of picture on the left gives you some sense of the tenement buildings which get set up. And on the other side, of course, I'm sorry it's not clearer, but this is, as it were, a slum street in East London in the 1890s. As you can see, lots of people are outside their houses because, particularly in hot weather, it's pretty insufferable inside. Given the seasonal economy, the tendency towards underemployment, and the ways in which that produces debt of various kinds, and given the sort of fairly low level of conduct of landlords themselves, the expectation of civilized relation between landlord and tenant wasn't very high. And when families couldn't cope with an arrears in rental, then they would tend to do what was called at the time a moonlight flit. In fact, there's a famous musical song, which some of you may know from Mary Lloyd, called My Old Man Said Follow the Van, that is actually about this process of moving on the quiet while the landlord doesn't know that you've left. So that's the moonlight flit. I'm sure it's not clearer. A lot of work in Victorian London was ingenious forms of street activity. Rag and bone men were probably the most sophisticated version of this, but whatever could make some sort of scrap of living tended to happen on the streets. And there's a picture on the left. And of course, we're lucky as historians that we've got the wonderful descriptions left by Mayhew in his interviews with all these people. They actually, you know, humanly come to life as to what their lives are about. And so we can picture this economy, I think, in graphic ways which very often wouldn't be possible in other places and other times. This is what do children do in these slums? Well, they don't obviously altogether have a miserable time. Here's a picture of them playing a makeshift sort of roundabout out of a lamppost. But here you can see there's an extraordinarily high density of one-room apartments in these places, very often with a crowded family, like the one you can see in this picture. God knows what it meant for, you know, domestic relations, for bullying, for all sorts of things. There's a Royal Commission on Housing in the mid-1880s, which reveals a lot of the problems which we only see the surface of, but even Lord Shaftesbury had sort of, in a veiled allusion, said, you know, incest was one of the problems which you got associated with these sorts of overcrowded conditions, and obviously what we call child abuse could have been rife. Let's see. Well, the standard responses in the period I'm talking about in London were thought to be a form of charity which would distinguish between the deserving poor and those who are undeserving. This classically was done by the charity organisation society, which developed a very sort of sophisticated set of classifications about how various different bits of the poor were to be treated. And that, although it was, you know, it's fairly objectionable in terms of deserving and undeserving, it was slightly better than if you go back to the literature of the 1830s and 40s, where they were all considered to be undeserving. This at least was trying to do certain good for an artisan who had lost his tools, this sort of thing. They did try and help. And of course, the charity organisation society is the ancestor of the Family Welfare Association, which will continue to defend this this Victorian record. And of course, you've got Octavia Hill, who's another example. What she imposed, I mean, she did do a lot of good in the sense of trying to rehabilitate existing properties rather than rebuild. But she did have extremely rigorous and severe moral code, which the tenants had to abide by. So it's not clear how well this really worked, given the conditions of the time. What we're seeing in this picture is anxiety about the position of the poor in Victorian London gradually increases from the 1860s through to the 1880s, partly because a number of trades are in decline, and declining trades means more underemployment, means more casualisation of labour, these conditions begin to create a sort of moral panic among middle-class propertied people. In particular, given the pressure on space and the poor housing, there was the fear that somehow the deserving and the undeserving were being crowded together indiscriminately in the same sorts of housing, and that the bad behaviour of the one was going to corrupt the good behaviour of the other. And this is a major fear around the 1880s. This was the point where this fear was at its worst. I don't want to exaggerate it, but was when there began to be demonstrations by radicals and socialists from the early 1880s onwards, beginning with followers of Henry George and so on, and then early socialist organisations like the Social Democratic Federation. They had a demonstration in Victoria in Trafalgar Square. Some of the demonstrators broke out into Pall Mall, and they smashed a few windows of the West End clubs. And you can imagine this caused a tremendous panic at the time, and the fear that civilization might be coming to an end. However, one shouldn't exaggerate, and this is partly, I'm afraid I haven't, or if I can just move to this one. Three years later, we've got the great dock strike of 1889. And it's one of the few strikes in history, if you like, which the city positively welcomed. Partly as in the aftermath of the 1886 West End riots, where there was a fear, you know, just of depredations of the unpropertied, here at last was a demonstration, organised demonstrations against dock companies, which indeed, whose behaviour was not very, very well regarded, but disciplined demonstrations, five in a row, no robbery, no violence, no looting, etc., etc. And this gets welcomed very strongly by the press of the day, and it's very much the part of the framework which gets created, which is the beginning of trying to resolve some of the problems I've been talking about. What it leads to, for instance, most immediately, is a much stricter sort of classification of those seeking dock employment. And with some sort of protection now given by the trade unions. So it's no longer just at the mercy of individuals and employers. There are the beginnings in the 1890s of various trade unions who are being given some sort of legitimacy to intervene in the struggles. The famous struggle, again, this was the struggle of, I think, 1887, match girls. It was a notoriously dangerous trade because it used phosphorus, and the girls employed very often had early deaths as a result of that. Anyway, it did result in a strike and the beginnings of some sort of primitive health and safety legislation as a result. So this is the point, I think, where I must hand over to Jane, who's going to talk about the situation now.
So in my comments, I want to try and explore similarities and differences to the story you've just heard. And sitting earlier in this room listening to Vinay's talk about what's going on with waste pickers in India, I'm struck by the massive similarities to what you were talking about too. So I think this is actually a global phenomenon about the nature of our labour market. And when Gareth was doing his study, he thought he was talking about history. And now we're talking about what's going on now. And the bit that's interesting and different is the bit between our two historical periods. And Gareth is going to say a bit more later on about what happened in those unusual years in between. So really, I'm going to just whiz through three key arguments about what's similar and different. The first is about sweating. Because although we don't think about sweated labour in the way that Gareth was talking about it, in many ways, sweating has now become paradigmatic. It's built into our employment relationships. And I'm going to say how that is. Then the second thing is there's still massive un- and underemployment and the oversupply of low-wage labour. But what's interesting now is that the differences are how international that labour supply is compared to the period that Gareth was talking about. Although, of course, there were Irish immigrants, Jewish immigrants in East London. There's always been an immigrant story. What's interesting today is the extent of the internationalisation, the rapid speed of change and the super diversity of the labour supply. And then the third big thing is about the role of the state, because that internationalisation is partly about immigration law. Of course, we have unemployment benefits so that people are spared from the workhouse that Gareth was talking about. But we also then have benefit entitlements that differentiate the hiring queue. And so the role of the state in passing laws has played a big part in determining who gets which jobs and the way in which the labour market's segmented. And also often neglected is the role of in-work state benefits that are propping up this labour system now and actually acting as a massive subsidy to low-wage employers. And I'm going to say something very briefly about that. So first of all, then, sweated labour. The Oxford English Dictionary gives us a definition up there, which is it's about goods, workers or labour produced by or subjected to long hours under poor conditions. And in many senses, what sweated labour is really about is about recovery. Vinay used the word recuperate. Can the labour actually recuperate, recover itself after the ardour on the conditions of work? And that involves time. So the eight-hour day, of course, was a big thing about having time to rest, time for leisure, time for family, time to recuperate. But of course, it's also about money. And if you don't earn enough to put the food on the table, you're also forced to sweat yourself. So you might not sweat for one employer, but you might sweat for three or four employers and build up your hours of work during a day. So sweating can be about being sweated by one employer, or it can be about sweating yourself and having to be forced to work more and more hours to put food on the table. Now, what's interesting about the response to sweated trades is that in the early years of the 20th century, Winston Churchill, who's a well-known conservative, pioneered in the House of Commons legislation against sweating. So as he said, it's a serious national evil that any class of His Majesty's subjects should receive less than the living wage in return for their utmost exertions. And he pushed a law through Parliament which set up what were called trade boards in four sweated industries. And these were ready and bespoke tailoring, paper box making, lace finishing, and chain making. And these were exactly the kinds of trades that Gareth was talking about that were going on in small workshops in the East End of London, in what were obviously classically sweated labour conditions. So this was a kind of geography of sweatedness being in small areas or associated with particular trades. And it's interesting, 10 years later, the law was revised to extend the list of trades that were sweated. But sweating was sort of about a kind of contained group of industries and conditions and places. What's interesting about the 21st century is the way in which sweating, in a way, has become endemic. It's become paradigmatic. Because when we started to do the research for Global Cities at Work, we decided to look at classically low-wage labour in London, so that the what you might call trades up there, the occupations up there, cleaning, hospitality, care, construction, food processing. We wanted to understand the dynamics of low-wage work in London. We decided those were key industries. We went out to look what was going on, and in every case, almost all the workers we encountered were in subcontracted employment relationships. So we talked to over 400 workers across those groups, and they were all, in some way or another, working for subcontracted employers. Now, subcontracting sounds very benign, so the Oxford English Dictionary there says it means to employ a firm to do work as part of a larger project. Sounds incredibly benign, but this is the route through which sweating has become more paradigmatic. And it's had huge consequences. So obviously it happens now across manufacturing. So no logo was a famous statement of the way in which most of the big brand manufacturers now organise all their supply through subcontracted supply chains that stretch around the globe. It's absolutely endemic across construction, routine services, food, basic manufacturing in the nearer to home markets, and increasingly at high-end services. What's also been interesting is the way in that this started in the 1980s as a political project, but it's also now spread to things like self-employment is going up massively. So now 14% of the UK labour market is self-employed, and often, although some of that is high-end people who want to avoid paying tax and get themselves labelled as a small business to avoid corporation tax and personal income tax and so on, much of it is people who are doing the job they always used to do but are now self-employed, and they're seen as an entrepreneur rather than a worker. And of course, the most obvious part of this is zero-hour contracts, so where people don't have any fixed terms and conditions of work, and they just have to be at the beck and call of employers. And that now seems to be about 10% of the UK labour force. So what was started really with subcontracting has now become much wider, and we could argue that subcontracting has kind of opened the door to sweating becoming paradigmatic and becoming the new normal. And at the bottom of the slide there, I've just put that flyer for the Adam Brooks hospital workers. So in 1980s, there were a whole raft of different industrial disputes where unions tried to challenge the outsourcing of employment and the start of subcontracting. So the NHS in 1983 was forced to start market testing for their routinised service work like domestics, cleaning, catering. And likewise, in local government, we had something called CCT, compulsory competitive tendering. And there were a whole round of industrial disputes where unions tried to challenge that and often failed. So one of my first ever experiences of picket line was going to Adam Brooks as a student to support that picket line. And here I am, like 25, 30 years later, still talking about the same things. I never thought that would happen. What it's really about, of course, as well, is employers avoiding responsibility for their workforce. And I'll say something about that in a minute. Just to give you some figures about why this, to convince you, if you like, this is happening, these are old data now from 1998, showing that 90% of workplaces in the country had already subcontracted one or more services. You can see there on the left the list about freelance workers, fixed-term contracts, zero-hour contracts. All those things have increased dramatically, particularly during the last period of austerity and economic crisis. And here's a slide on self-employment. The fact that it's going up very, very rapidly and now accounts in official statistics for 14% of the labour force in the UK. Increasing numbers of them are over 50 years old as well, so it's often people who are made redundant and then they end up working often for their same ex-employer but on inferior terms and conditions of work. So what does all that mean for work? It basically means that subcontracting basically means you get the job done for less, So you're encouraging competition between suppliers to drive down the cost of the job. It has incredible effects in terms of wages, because every time the contractor tendered, there's pressure on wages and conditions. And despite some protection for that in UK law, wages are falling for the new workers that are brought in on the contract, what's called a two-tier workforce. Probably the most profound thing is the end of what we used to call a social wage. So anything above the absolute minimum, the national minimum wage, so pension entitlements, overtime rates, so you get paid time and a half for working overtime, all those kinds of extra benefits, maternity rights, sick leave, they've been absolutely eroded from this labour force. So when we went out and talked to 400 plus people in different sectors of low wage work, most of them had none of those social benefits at all. As I've said, it prompts workers to sweat themselves, but perhaps most importantly, it erodes the space from which Labour had power. So Gareth ended his talk by talking about how unions started to form, new unionism, that really electrified the country, and union rates went up very dramatically in the beginning of the 20th century, as unions began to exert their power by organising people in their place of work. So the geography of this was workplace trade unionism that allowed workers to collectively bargain over their conditions of work. In a subcontracted employment relationship, if you organise yourself, you price yourself out of the market, and you're not dealing with the real employers that set the terms and conditions of work. So it's had a tremendous effect on the terms and conditions of work. Just to give you one quick example, in the study we looked at one tower at Canary Wharf, where there's 105 workers cleaning the building. Since it opened in 1991, there have been four different cleaning contractors. So that means the workers who were there were moved between contractors each time the contract was re-tendered. So there was a couple of people who'd been there right the way through, and they'd had four different employers doing the same job. Lots of them were working nights, and their wages were sort of a pound above the minimum wage and a pound less than the living wage. But they had none of that social wage. No sick pay, only statutory holidays, no overtime rates, no pay for lunches, no pension, and no annual pay rise. So there was no expectation that every year there'd be a pay rise. And what's particularly interesting probably is that 76% of that workforce were born outside the UK. So this tremendous change that's gone on in the terms and conditions of work is associated with a massive change in the characteristics of the people doing the jobs. And as you can see, most of them have been there less than 2 years, so very rapid rates of labour turnover. So these labour forces are changing very, very rapidly, partly because of the conditions of work. So what subcontracting does is increases the volume of work. And I won't read these quotes out, but they're from Global Cities at Work and their workers' testimony about the experience of being in a workforce where you're constantly expected to do more work, an increasing volume of work. But also, interestingly, there's often an expectation of increased skills. So particularly in areas like care, home care, what used to be about going to the shop and helping somebody cook some meals or do some shopping was now becoming more and more medicalised, and yet the rates of pay were going down, if anything, in real terms. So a dramatic change in both those aspects of work, and a fall in real wages over that period. So this slide shows rates of pay between 1993 and 2005 for low-wage occupations, and for all workers, rates of pay went up in real terms in both in London and out of London. There were much greater increases in London. But when you look at low-wage subcontracted workers, their rates of pay fell in London, and fell in London often much more than they fell outside. So for domestics, their rate of pay went down by 12p in the first period and 44p an hour in the second period. So there's been a tremendous downward pressure on the terms and conditions of work for people in low-wage employment. What this all adds up to is about 20% of the UK labour force getting less than a living wage. So about one in five workers is definitely sweated because they're paid less than you need to live. And in London, that's about 18% of the workforce. And these smaller bars show you the fact that it's women part-time workers who suffer low wages the most. And when you map that onto place of residence, as you might expect, it's the areas of cheaper, there's nowhere cheap in London anymore, but cheaper housing where those workers are concentrated. And in contrast to Gareth's period, when we were sort of in a central East London, that map is moving out. So it's moving to outer London, and there's more and more poverty concentrated in outer London boroughs as the inner London boroughs become increasingly gentrified. So for a borough like Tower Hamlets, where Queen Mary's located, what you now find is a dramatic difference between the very highest paid and the very lowest paid living cheek by jowl, because people are still in social housing where they managed to get in it 20, 30 years ago, and new arrivals to the low-wage labour market are living out in Barking and Dagenham, Enfield, Harrow, and on the fringes of London, and having to pay more of their income travelling to jobs in the centre. So people are often spending 2 or 3 hours on a bus every day because it's cheaper than the tube to get to work. So as I said, one of the interesting differences about the two periods is this internationalisation of labour supply, which we called a migrant division of labour. And that's partly because of access to benefits. So whereas British-born or British-naturalised people who are looking for low-wage work are often better on benefits and claiming unemployment benefit and housing benefit, particularly as it's so expensive to live in London, it's the international arrivals who don't have access to benefits who become the preferred labour supply. So particularly international students, and universities have got quite a bit to play in this. The number of international students in London is very, very high. They're not entitled to benefits. They can work for 20 hours a week. And in many of these workplaces, it's international students of various kinds, not just at universities, but language colleges and so on, who've been filling a lot of these jobs. There's also a massive dual framework in the way that workers like those assess the rates of pay. So the difference between the Polish rate of pay and the London rate of pay is still huge. And so when new arrivals come, it makes more sense to them to work than it would to someone who's trying to provide for a household in London as it gets increasingly expensive. These kind of rules about who can get what in the labour market and which kind of benefits have differentiated the employer hiring queue. And as A8 of migrants have arrived from Europe, so people have come from Poland and Lithuania and Latvia in increasing numbers, they're white workers, the employers know that they have their papers, they're free to work in the UK, and they have tended to mean that the employer's hiring queue becomes racialised. So the black workers, particularly from Nigeria and Ghana that we met, who were really propping up our care system and our hospitality industries, have tended to be squeezed out as there's a churn in labour hiring. And the Eastern Europeans have often been the preference in terms of labour supply. So there's a very, very sharp racialisation in these hiring queues. It's also interesting that lots of the narrative in academic work is about social networks being key to getting a job. And we expected to find workplaces where everyone was from Brazil or Poland or Lithuania or Ghana. But when we came to look at these workplaces, you find this super diversity even within one workplace. So these dots on the map show you the origins of the workers who are cleaning that building at Canary Wharf. 105 workers from 21 different countries of origin. And that's facilitated partly by social networks, but also the speed of labour turnover. So people are moving because it's their only strategy for improvement, for 10 pence extra an hour or 20 pence extra an hour, another building. So the churn is very high, the arrival rate is very high, and it means that employers are constantly redifferentiating their hiring queues. And you get workplaces where people can barely talk to each other at all because the diversity of languages is so great. So if you imagine you were trying to unionise that workforce, the rate of turnover is phenomenally difficult. The language diversity is difficult. The shifts are difficult. And of course, most of those workers have got other jobs as a means of survival. So it gets very difficult to build a cohesive sense of solidarity amongst such a fluid, mobile population. What this means kind of writ large beyond the workplace is that our low-wage occupations are increasingly reliant on foreign-born workers. So these graphs show you the upward trajectory in cleaners, care assistants, catering assistants and chefs and cooks of the workforce that are born outside the UK. So we've become very dependent on workers born outside the UK, filling these gaps in our labour market, such that 37% of London's population were now born outside the UK. So it's a tremendous change because it's happened relatively quickly, and it's emblematic across all. You can see this pattern right across all our workplaces in London. So this begs the question of how people survive. If they're not getting the living wage, it raises big questions about survival, which Vinay was talking about too. How do people generate income? Obviously, long hours of labour is the obvious way. So people are working overtime, but at their flat rate of pay. They're not getting extra pay for that. People are doing multiple jobs. So we met one woman who is doing three jobs. She worked as a hospital domestic in the mornings. She then had a few home care clients that she popped in to see on the way home, though that was all zero-hour contracts. So if people went into hospital, they weren't there, she didn't have the job. And then she would turn up at Canary Wharf to work as an office cleaner during the night. So she was sleeping a few hours every day, often falling asleep on the bus going home and having to be woken up. And really, that was sweating in extremis, but lots of people had two jobs. Or they were sort of being entrepreneurial, importing goods, trying to set up businesses, trying to generate income. Another thing was about sharing childcare. So quite a few families, the one worker would work all night and one worker would work all day, and then the handover would be looking after the kids rather than going to bed. So if you walk in the morning, you're picking up the childcare or taking the kids to school, you're not going to bed. And then likewise, you're handing over to partners at the end of the day. And a huge emphasis on trying to find a way of surviving by cutting down costs, sharing housing, and so on. Un and underemployment was the third major area where things were similar but also different, not least because of access to benefits. So the cost to employment in London is really high. It costs a lot to go to work because of transport costs, childcare costs, housing costs, which just go up and up every year. So it means if you're able to claim benefits, it's often much better to do so. And this means then that what the government has done, and the Labour government, new Labour government started to do this, was to increase the incentives to work. So what we had during the boom years of the 1980s and 90s is high rates of unemployment alongside high rates of immigration. Those two things were going together. And then in the late 90s, the new Labour government decided they need to increase the incentives to work. So they brought in work benefits. And what we've seen over the last decade or so is a huge rate of increase in the amount of money that the Treasury is paying to people who are already in work. And in-work benefits are going up rapidly. You can see here that tax credits now account for about 30 billion of Exchequer spending. Housing benefit for people in work is going up incredibly rapidly. And what this really amounts to is a subsidy to low-wage employers. So low-wage employers can, Tesco's for instance, can get their labour supply. They're not paying them a living wage. It's topped up by the government. And there's no pressure for them to put up wages. So it's a well-meaning intervention into a labour market, which is now it's a Frankenstein monster that's constantly being fed without any political pressure being put on people to put up wages in any meaningful sense. So making work pay is actually about us paying as taxpayers to subsidise this labour force. And often that can amount to huge amounts of money. I'm not going to read this out, but we did some modelling a few years ago to think about the effects of people being paid the living wage instead of the minimum wage. And we looked into what kind of benefit entitlement people have. And if you have a couple with three children in various circumstances, which we made calculations about on the minimum wage, they would be getting hundreds of pounds a week in tax credits from the Treasury just to allow them to survive. So there's a kind of policy recognition that poverty pay is a major public problem. It's a collective problem because people are too poor to support their children. And then the solution to that has been to give them benefits, but that means that the employers are left off the hook. And we estimated that if all workers in London who are not getting a living wage got a living wage, it would save the Exchequer about £800 million a year. If you roll that out across the whole UK, you're talking about billions of pounds. So there's a kind of very powerful argument that could be made about shifting the responsibility for low wages from the taxpayer, the Treasury, to low-wage employers. So that's the kind of doom and gloom. But then the big question, of course, is where's the power to change these things? And it's interesting, this quote from the Nigerian representative at the top, who's arguing about how that his community have got the keys to the city. They're the people who open the buildings. They've got tremendous power. Without them, the city would collapse. But at the same time, that power is not mobilised. And it's very interesting to look back at the first wave of immigration that came to the UK after the Second World War, reading those accounts of people who arrived from the Caribbean, from the Indian subcontinent, interestingly put into very similar positions in the labour market. But the political responses to that were self-organisation, organisation around an identity, often as black, organising within the Labour Party, within local government, to try and change the narrative and discourse around their position within the UK and as citizens. And when you look at the current situation, you often find it's much more fragmented. So that super diversity means that a lot of these groups of workers are very fragmented in their own language groups, their own national groups, in very different circumstances, often in relation to citizenship and the asylum system and so on. But what has struck us is the fact that the most powerful affiliation or space of solidarity in their lives often is faith organisations, particularly those from Africa, and to a lesser extent Latin America. And so it's from here that you can see the connection to the Living Wage campaign, which I'll just say a very little thing about. So the only real effort or success so far that's been able to kind of shift this downward pressure on wages is the notion of a living wage. So the Living Wage campaign was launched in 2001, and its origins are in a broad-based community coalition that is about half faith organisations and then civil society organisations, labour groups, schools, lots of schools, community groups. And the Living Wage campaign was launched in 2001 as an attempt to intervene into this labour market. And everybody said it was crazy. It was never going to win anything. It was never going to work. Not least because the unions, as I said, have been trying to fight privatisations and outsourcing for decades and not getting anywhere. So what happened was early on, the battles were very intense. So this is Homerton Hospital in East London, where domestic workers were fighting for the living wage. And likewise, at Canary Wharf, a lot of those cleaners I mentioned started to join unions and work with the campaign to demand a living wage. And it took several years for the first victory, for the first organisation to agree to do it. And since then, the campaign has taken off. So there's now about 800 organisations across the UK that have signed up to be living wage employers. That affects thousands of workers, and it's involved millions of pounds of money being redistributed to low-wage workers. And the rate of pay is about 40% above the national minimum wage in London. So it's a very, very sizable amount of money, and it's caught the imagination of increasing numbers of people. Which is something that gives us some hope about the scope for organising today. So, past and present then. It's interesting looking at the period Gareth was talking about, because the Webs were talking about shifting the law of supply and demand in labour to the law of the living wage. And in the 20th century, many people thought that battle had been won. And the period we're talking about, of course, is pushing us back. But the campaign for a living wage is striking because it's a different kind of politics. It's about a coalition across a lot of different groups, and part of the narrative is about using the market to win the demand. So the argument with the supermarkets and so on is to, a bit like fair trade, is to say, use this logo, brand your organisation as ethical, and try and mobilise the consumer to buy living wage and support living wage. Likewise, public sector procurement, there were arguments made around the Olympics to push through the living wage in public sector procurement, arguing that public sector money should not be supporting poverty jobs. So there's similarities and differences in terms of the political response. Now, Gareth's going to say a few words about the period in between, and then we've just got a few final comments about the kind of ideas we used to think about these things.
Well, thank you very much, Jane. One of the things I think we can be pleased about is Queen Mary, to which we both belong, is a living wage employer. What I'm going to talk about briefly, having given you some snapshots of what Victorian casual labour looked like, is the period of actual improvement between the First World War and the 1960s. And so a very brief, as it were, history of London between what I first talked about and what Jane is talking about now. When I first began work myself on Outcast London in the mid-1960s, there were still sort of traces of the old Outcast London which I had described. The Port of London and its dock system, which had seemed to be facing terminal decline at the end of the 19th century, actually regained its authority and remained, believe it or not, until the mid-1960s, the largest port in the world. And there were still, when I began my research, there were still registered dockers performing sorts of labour which were not dissimilar from their Victorian or Edwardian ancestors. There were still lodging houses, cafes, Christian missions to help destitute seamen. There was Bloom's, which was a reminder of the once very large Jewish community in Whitechapel. And the East End clothing industry, which had been already taken over in 1960 by the Bangladeshis. They'd started before the Second World War. The East End as a whole in 1960 to 70 still had a faintly sinister reputation, memories of Jack the Ripper, of Russian anarchists, and stories, of course, more up to date about the Cray brothers and East End gangland criminality. And further west, there were still the great wholesale food markets, Covent Garden, Smithfield, Billingsgate, and the porters who served them were still in place. Commonwealth immigration from the West Indies and the Indian subcontinent was still virtually unlimited until 1962. Of course, it was much talked about. It had been the target of poor white rioters in Notting Hill in 1958, and of course, the famous Enoch Powell's Powell Rivers of Blood speech in 1968, followed by mass strikes and demonstrations at Westminster by East End dockers. As late as 1872, there was also a march of Smithfield meat porters to support Powell. Fortunately, there weren't many actual clashes because most of the immigrants lived in places like Brixton or Southall and were therefore geographically removed from where the porters and dockers and so on were. And in central London, when I started work, there was still around Soho, there were still the remnants of a pre-war European migration, German, Italian, Hungarian, some of them rather sort of murky fascist past, some of them in the Italian, still Italians living in Clerkenwell, going back to Garibaldi and so on. So there was still a sort of recognisable 19th century London, which you could find just beneath the surface. Being transformed, of course, when I started work, the theatre land around south of Shaftesbury Avenue, was the beginning of the Chinatown. Chinatown in Gerrard Street, which had begun so I'm told, when the Chinese got pushed out of the East End by the Blitz during the Second World War. So what separated that world from the 1840s, from the London of the 1860s? Well, above all, I think it was the First World War. For during the war, during the years between 1914 and 1918, the Edwardian and Victorian problem of casual labour, as it was understood by countless inquiries before 1914, more or less ceased to exist. There was an unheard-of demand for labour. The workhouse population fell by one-third. Soldiers and port workers from Southampton had to be drafted in to meet the demand for labour in the docks. Once again, you get much use being made of child labour. Wages increased by an unimaginable amount. Before 1914, a London dock labourer had earned 5 shillings and 10 pence a day when he could get work. In 1918, he earned 11 shillings and 9 pence and enjoyed much more regular employment. Parallel changes also alleviated the plight of poor families. The birth rate had begun to decline, and nationally, 1.5 million women were drawn into manufacturing, commercial, and service industries. Wives and daughters, therefore, could now find an alternative to homework with work in the factories and to avoid the unhealthy conditions of the sweated workshop. The period between the 1930s and the 1970s was one, therefore, of diminishing differentials between male and female wages, between skilled and unskilled wages, between rich and poor. After the First World War, unskilled wage rates did not sink back to their previous level. The ratio of unskilled to skilled wage rates improved. While a labourer in an engineering factory earned 52% of a pattern maker's wage in 1914, after the war, he earned 75%. So you can see these differentials are declining. Unlike the depressed industrial regions in the interwar period, like Scotland, South Wales, Lancashire, and the North East, London retained a buoyant labour market. It promised an improved standard of life and, of course, attracted migrants from all over the United Kingdom. Of the net increase of 644 factories employing more than 25 persons between 1932 and 1937, 83% were located in Greater London. The increase in factory employment for women, especially in West London, along the Great West Road, was matched by the continued viability of the skilled workshop production in the centre. In an era of diminished world trade, the Port of London retained its supremacy, focusing its attention increasingly upon the Empire. The unregulated scramble for work at the dock gates was increasingly regulated in conjunction, as I said, with the trade unions. Increased levels of comfort alongside a more settled labouring population was expressed in the purchase of better furniture in the home, visits to the cinema, seaside holidays, lipstick, and the growing crowds at Speedway and Greyhound events. During the Second World War, however, London's supremacy as a centre of manufacture was irreparably damaged by the Blitz. The docks and warehouses of the Port of London and the service industries which supplied them were the hardest hit. Munitions moved out of London. The precision industries like furniture and clothing, previously clustered in central London and the northeastern perimeter of the city, like Shoreditch and Finsbury, were to a large extent bombed out of existence. Between 1938 and 1947, inner London lost 170,000 jobs. But even so, the activity of the port survived for 20 years after the war. After the war, factories, warehouses and workshops relocated with official both LCC encouragement and government encouragement to the suburbs or out of London altogether. Mainly as a result of bomb damage, many skilled workers moved out to the suburbs, and their work followed them. The zoning policies of the London County Council also hastened a process of de-industrialisation. or industrial decentralisation. Much of the remaining population of Inner London was rehoused in the 1920s in council estates and from the 1960s in tower blocks. The nature and location of work also shifted. In place of the factory and the workshop, office employment became ever more dominant. In the 1950s, it provided 56,000 new jobs. Furthermore, the benefits of new forms of economic activity were mainly concentrated in West London rather than East London. Above all, the establishment, of course, of London Airport at Heathrow in 1943. That provided a major boost to employment in transport, commerce and tourism. By 1958, it had resulted directly in the creation of 26,000 jobs, plus a multitude of hotels, warehouses and ancillary forms of local transport to assist the transport of persons and goods. When Outcast London was conceived, therefore, much of the economy and the social geography it had described had been relocated. But what was not wholly apparent at the time, The 1960s were the last years of exceptional prosperity, I think, for London. World output of manufactures quadrupled between the early 50s and the early 70s, and world trade in manufactured goods grew tenfold. The average West European unemployment rate stood at 1.5%. London appeared to be sharing in that prosperity. These were the years of swinging London and the huge boost to tourism, music and fashion industries that accompanied it. It also seemed then that the more traditional economic activities were holding their own. In the years 1962 to 1964, shipping in the Port of London reached a record level, and so did the tonnage of goods. But that was the end of it, really. The port then underwent a cataclysmic and terminal decline, together with many of the commercial and manufacturing activities which had depended upon it. Containerization, the use of roll-on, roll-off ferries, and the greater draft required by new shipping meant that docks in the upper pool were becoming unusable. And that was eventually recognised with the closure of St Catherine's Docks next to the Tower of London and its transformation into a marina. Yet, and they were pretty short-sighted, yet as late as 1964, the Port of London Authority had established a new dock house there and built a new warehouse complex. The management of the docks had not taken account of the growth either of an arterial road system and the increasing ubiquitous use of lorry transport. Thus, Tilbury was not provided with roads capable of accommodating the increasing volume of traffic. Also, it must be said that the behaviour of dock labourers in the late 60s through to the beginning of the 80s was pretty obstinate and fairly short-sighted, although what else they could have done remains to be asked. 37 strikes between 1945 and 1955 led ship owners to begin to transfer to European ports or use Felixstowe or Harwich or elsewhere. And from 1966 through to 1981, the numbers of strikes reached much larger proportions and the decline of the ports became headlong. The share of the Port of London in United Kingdom exports and imports fell from over 30% in 1964 to 12% in 1975, and by that stage had been overtaken by the airport, which accounted for 15%. Similarly, the number of registered dockers fell from 30,000 in 1960 to 2,000 in 1982. So the decline and fall of the Port of London formed the most dramatic part of a general contraction of manufacturing employment in London. The manufacturing workforce, 1.2 million in 1966, 940,000 in 1974, 435,000 in 1989, 240,000 in 1997. So, and the decline, which starts with the riverside industries, then carries through to the workshops of the city perimeter and eventually even affected the factory industries of Wales, of West and North West London. So that's really the background, I think, to the emergence of the sort of London that Jane has been talking about in in her her discussion just now. I just want to say that when I began this book, what it inspired me particularly, growing up in school in the late 1950s and early 1960s, that was the moment after Suez. It was the moment when it seemed that, or the age of decolonization, and there's an emerging literature about what then was called the Third World. And I got fascinated by the sort of underdevelopment that you got in the cities of the Third World. I particularly was impressed by, I did a lot of work in France, in my gap year as it were, was particularly impressed by a work by the anthropologist called Levi-Strauss called Tris Tropiques, which was about this condition of Third World cities at the time. And so I was inspired to think about conditions of development, economic development, economic theory while I was an undergraduate and so on, and wanted, or I didn't get there immediately, but what I did was then to try and apply some of that knowledge to a study of Victorian London. Just a couple of other things to say about it. One was that, again, my French connection in this sense was to lead me to be very interested in anthropology. And there's very exciting anthropology going on in France at the time. And I was at Nuffield College, where there are a number of French anthropologists I worked with. And they put me on to Marcel Mauss. And Marcel Mauss was one of the prime sort of social anthropologists at the beginning of the 20th century. And he wrote his classic book is called The Gift. So one of the things that any historian of 19th century London certainly has to deal with, and probably any contemporary observer of London has to deal with now, is gift relationships and what do they mean in terms of social relations. And so one of the things I looked at in the in Outcast London was what I called the deformation of the gift, the fear on the part of givers that they were losing control of when they gave, they expected something in return, and the sense in which casual labour, et cetera, was not yielding that in return. And that was creating more and more tension in the second half of the 19th century. The third thing I should just say very quickly was I worked on New Left Review at the time, and we got very interested in the latest theories. And one of them was by Louis Althusser, and I tried to apply some of his theories, in particular a notion of what was called the problematique. That meant that instead of looking at ideas in their context as being the product of particular social classes and representing their interests, what one looked at was the relationship between those ideas over a particular period and how they all, as it were, reinforced each other. What we would now call discourse, it was actually very similar. And in my study of Outcast London, I was very interested in the way in which in the 1850s and 60s, you had a more or less sort of what we now call a neoliberal interpretation, of poverty and the sense in which people didn't exercise thrift in the way that they should, because if they'd done that, they wouldn't be poor, was the sort of implication. But you get a much more pessimistic picture from the 1880s onwards, which I call degeneration, which was the sense you already had, as it were, social scientists saying that people born in London were, as it were, of declining mental and physical status. I mean, you've got healthy country people working on the land, but the more that people migrate to the cities, so their health is going to go down and their conditions are going to go down. And so this is a way in which Britain is going to suffer decline in relation to its competitor at the time, which was Germany. But anyway, these are some of the theories which I tried to apply in the book.
Well, we're almost done. but just thought it would be useful to think about how we think about these things, so the kind of categories that we use and the ideas we come to apply to this study. Because obviously when we started our work, we went to Marx and notions of class, and the reserve army of labour was an obvious place to start, because, and Vinay mentioned this earlier, huge oversupply of labour, and rather than in Marx's time where that was often quite local to the source of jobs and opportunities, in our case it seemed to be literally global and people were coming from all over the place. But I thought just at the end it'd be interesting to say something about the journey that this work has taken me, because my latest readings and thinking have been about the model of politics that lies behind the living wage campaign itself. So I encountered this as just a campaign around a demand. It seemed like a social movement. But digging away at this model of politics in broad-based community organising, it took me right back to the Chicago School and the sociologists at the turn of the century, who were trying to use this guy's ideas, John Dewey, about how the academy can play a role in democracy and strengthening democracy. And I found an amazing paper by Ernest Burgess in 1916, where he was extolling the virtues of the social survey and training his students to go out and immerse themselves in local societies in the city, finding key civil society leaders, thinking about how a coalition could be built amongst people for political voice and power. And one of Ernest Burgess' students was a guy called Saul Alinsky, and he went and applied these ideas in the back of the yards area of Chicago in the 1930s. And that was the first time that we had something that's now called broad-based community organizing. Obviously, people have always organized, but it's this particular model of linking groups like faith, labor, education, bringing people together, finding what they've got in common and organizing around that, because it's in the interests of democracy. And it's striking that there's a role for the academy there. So Dewey talks about how ideas should be about finding a problem, a shared problem, sharing intelligence and building a public around that problem, and then acting to do something about it. And that would put intellectual work right back at the heart of the process and the process of producing democracy itself. So this, you'll be glad to know, is our last slide, and we've kind of done it. But it's to just highlight these similarities and differences. But as I said earlier, I think the talk that Vinay gave could be up here too, that we're talking about very similar processes right across the globe in terms of the changing nature of our employment. And we need to think about imaginative solutions, about how we can build publics around the problems associated with this labour market to start doing something about it. So I'll shut up.
I just wanted to ask about one word in your title, the word representation, actually, and just sort of hone in on that a little bit, and just to ask you both whether you've got any thoughts about what some of the challenges might be today vis-a-vis representation. And you touched on this in your closing comments, Jane, but there's that sort of political organisation kind of work, but there's also, you know, the other kind of representation about how and what role the academy might play in changing the terms of the debate now, such that we no longer have to put up with talking about an immigration problem, for example, and how we can create new, or whether we might be able to create new terms of debate in the public sphere.
Well, I'm sure we've both got something to say. I would just say that one of the things we're having to battle against, particularly in the academy, is the way in which a certain forms of neoliberal theory have really overtaken the study of economics and current politics. And so a lot of the problems which particularly Jane exposed in her presentation could be sort of dismissed as sort of, well, that's just what economic life is like. What I think our representation, if you like, why academic work matters, is to show first of all, the fallacy of that sort of economics in terms of a humanly sustainable urban environment, but secondly, to show that very often its calculations are false, and in my case, its appeal to history is false. So I was very struck by what Jane said about state-assisted work in the sense of topping up poor wages and so on by the state. I mean, it's one thing that the 19th century is very clear they didn't want to do. It's called a rate in aid of wages, and that's why they set up the new poor law in the first place, too, precisely because they thought that the employers were actually getting a free ride of a captive labour market, and that should not happen. So partly I think what one can do is to show that a lot of the bases of present, for lack of a better word, government thinking are based on false premises, and one of the things that academics can do is to show the ways in which those assumptions are false.
Yeah, and I would just say the power of representation for me has been demonstrated by this term living wage. Because when workers were organised in unions and demanded improved wages, like 1% or 2%, well, we had our own dispute for whatever percentage, 2%, 3%, it doesn't travel. It really just stays in a silo. And the power of representation has been really amazing to see how the notion of a living wage travels and people can get it. And people on Newsnight and Question Time now regularly use this language of living wage, as though everybody knows what they're talking about. Whereas before 2001, it was not in our lexicon. It was in the earlier Victorian and early labour movement in the 1870s were using it. But it had fallen out of use completely. And just relabeling something and using new language can be incredibly powerful. And I think that's where the role of these inquiries in this Dewean sense can be incredibly powerful. Because we know we've got lots and lots of problems, housing, work, education, and if we bring different voices together in some sort of dialogue, you generate new ideas for how to solve them, and often those new ideas are about powerful representations. And so it's not saying we're on strike for my members want a pay rise, which doesn't travel, it's we all want a living wage, and it's something that, so the power of representation is massive.
Thank you. Really interesting lecture. Thank you very much. I was particularly intrigued, Jane, by what you were telling us about the role of faith as kind of a glue for organization. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more. Is it because it provides a space, or is it actively promoted by the institutional faith? I'm wondering what role does the minister or priest or whoever leaders play? Because I wonder if that wouldn't tell us about something about the transition of religion or faith through this period that you've covered in this very interesting juxtaposition. So I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more, please.
I mean, one thing is about the social fabric of the city. And if you look at communities like the ones around the college in East London, often the most significant civil society organisations where people assemble in relationship with each other are built around faith. So we have a massive plethora of different faith organisations. So if you take that Ernest Burgess thing to go out and map the community to kind of have an ethnography of a community, you're going to quickly get to the power of faith organisations. 30 years ago, the Labour Party and the trade unions might have played a bigger role in the social fabric of those communities, and there's been a massive decline, particularly in trade union organisation, but also the Labour Party representing poor people. So really, often faith are kind of the key institutions in those areas. And then if you can recruit significant people within them to join an alliance, you can then try and build relationships between those islands of social capital, those social groups, places where there is solidarity. And faith stands out because there is a value system that's often anti-materialistic. So it's been very moving to go to some of these Catholic masses, which are very well attended, where the Catholic priests will talk about Jesus being represented in everybody. There's a universalist language about humanity and the power of God in every human being, which makes connections between people. And the fact that these workers are sitting on the pews means that those leaders of those institutions often will move with their values to represent their interests and use that faith organisation as a way of bringing out people for political mobilisation. Because obviously, to get Boris, I didn't really have time to go into it, but people like Boris Johnson, Conservative Mayor of London, has been signed up to the living wage and has promoted it. It means all tube cleaners in London get paid the living wage. And they were all on minimum wage, working all night cleaning those trains and tunnels. They're all paid the living wage. And the only reason he's signed up to it is because 2,000 people can be mobilised to turn out to a big political meeting where he's asked, will you support it, yes or no? It's really big, it's about the power of organised people. So obviously these workers have no money, but they do have potential in terms of their democratic citizenship or their democratic turnout, even if they haven't got papers. And so that's been mobilised to good effect to sign up key leaders in the political sphere to agree to things that they otherwise wouldn't have done. So I don't know if that's answered your question, but it's about social capital, values and mobilisation.
Perhaps I could just add that I think part of one of the bad effects eventually of this period between 1920 and 1970 is that, of course, it was very good that trade unions increased in power, but they, by the same token, certainly from the 60s, lost the sense of having to be part of the communities to which they belonged. And in that sense, it made it much easier for the Mrs. Thatchers of the world to start sort of demonising them in a way that the press has continued ever since. And so part of what I think is great about the initiative of living wage, which Jane talks about, is the way in which it's reconstituting a campaign on the basis of communities of workers or inhabitants in particular places, which gets away from the old discourses about trade union power and so on, and focuses on what really matters, and also because it's a way of making the representations human of all these workers who come from all over the world and show that their needs are to be taken account of. And that's one of the areas in which faith organisations can play a particularly positive role, I think.
Okay, thanks for your presentation. I was wondering about the living wage campaign, if that's also combined with demands around pay inequality, about high pay, and particularly the pay of those at the top being kind of very, very much, much higher than it used to be in the past, or is it focused, entirely on the living wage, or is it also combined with demands around sort of pay inequality and around the pay of those at the top?
The answer to that is no. It's all been about raising the bottom. And part of its virtue is that it's really simple. It's a really simple message. It's a living wage. It's an official rate. So it's calculated by arm's length bodies to depoliticize it. And it's based on the real cost of living. And so it's a simple rate, it's a simple demand, and everybody can understand it. There are separate campaigns about the things you're talking about. So there was a high pay commission, and there's been calls for reducing the ratio between the top 10% and the bottom 10%, but that's a separate campaign. Though I would say the campaign has been very interesting in taking the testimony, the power of testimony of low-wage workers right to the heart of these boardrooms. Because what subcontracting does is means that the people who are really in charge, the people at Canary Wharf who settle procure the contracts and so on and wash their hands of responsibility for the people doing their work, never think about those people, never meet them, have no conception of the consequences of their action. So then if you bring that testimony into their office through the campaign, often they're very shocked. It sounds ridiculously the case that they can be so naive, but they're often really shocked to hear testimony about what it's like to live on the minimum wage in London, trying to support a family, trying to get kids through school. And that's often the time that is most powerful in the campaign, where very senior executives who are paid huge amounts of money and live in a completely separate realm meet the people who are cleaning their office and actually hear from them and get to know them. And sometimes that's the moment that they sign up to the living wage. And then once you get to the top to sign up, suddenly everything's possible. It doesn't cost that much to change the wages of the security staff, the catering staff, the cleaning staff in these big towers. It's a tiny percentage of their overall operating budget. So once you get that emotional moment, other things become possible.
You talked about the vast increase in benefit within workplaces that the subsidy is provided to the employer in this way. What are the sites of political struggle present, or are there any, where the burden can be shifted back to the social wage and maternity benefit and all those things that, you know, trade unions used to do but no longer want to do?
Well, the living wage is the main one, because what the living wage does is basically says that Tesco's, for instance, should pay a living wage, and then that would reduce the benefit bill. Because when you're on tax credits, when your income goes up, your benefits go down. So the problem, though, is that often for workers, why would they organise? Because their net pay is not going to, or their net income is not going to change. The balance about how much they get from the employer versus the state will change, because as the employer puts more in, the state puts less, but their actual income is not going to change, which is why it pulls the rug from under trade unions massively. So I'm amazed the Labour movement allowed Gordon Brown to do tax credits, because it undermines their whole reason for existence, because there was no incentive. But saying that, most workers would rather feel the dignity of earning a living wage rather than having it paid through benefits, because there's huge stigma around benefits. So I think workers much, much prefer to get it through what they think of as a proper dignified wage than they do from welfare. But the main push has been around the demand for a living wage. Interestingly, Panorama, though, are doing a programme in a couple of weeks about this very question, so I'm interested to see what effect that might have. Because in a way, it's a hidden subsidy. We don't talk about it in the public domain, and the cost of it's going up. So the government are concerned about the cost of the welfare bill, and particularly in London, if they say that they want social housing rates to go up to 80% of market value, which is what the official coalition policy is, basically what that means is that the Treasury in Loughton will be paying those rents, because they're paid to people who are off on unemployment benefit or in work. So they're just kind of moving money from one bit of government to another and not solving the structural problem, which is about the lack of affordable housing and low wages, and those two things going together and bankrupting the state.
Many thanks for a really wonderful presentation. As a sociologist, I was very happy to hear the Chicago School of Sociology mentioned, and Burgess mentioned, not just to trash the zonal hypothesis, which is the kind of standard geographer's version. If you dig deeper in the Chicago School, you'll actually find very early ethnographies conducted by women who are written out of the history of the social sciences. Annie Marion McLean in 1902 was conducting ethnographies in factories in Chicago, was traveling, was a traveling laborer as a hop picker, wrote work on factory legislation. So there's a lot of things to dig up there that are sort of interesting and precedents. But my question, I guess, is the living wage campaign is fantastic, and the London, I know the panel was focused on London, but I'm just wondering, historically and in the contemporary period, could we kind of internationalize it and think of things that were happening in 1901 elsewhere that influenced what happened in London? And similarly, how can what's happening in London with the ongoing success and the building success of the London Living Wage campaign, how that might be internationalized and some strategies we could think of around that?
Yeah, well, I should have said that the idea in many senses came from Baltimore, 1994. Baltimore, using the same model of politics, which is linked to the Industrial Areas Foundation, launched a living wage campaign in Baltimore that was successful in 1994. And that was really where the idea for this type of organisation and demand came from. So although there was a pressing issue around low wages in East London, the coalition looked for ideas and had a relationship with Baltimore, a personal relationship through an organiser who used to come over called Jonathan Lang to mentor the people in London. So it's no coincidence that that's the way that ideas do travel. And again, that is the power of representation and ideas, because often they do travel. And since the success in London, it's now gone to the whole country. So the National Living Wage Foundation, who's doing all this accreditation. And there's often links to other organisations picking up the same kind of demands. And it's interesting, the Clean Clothes campaign, for instance, has got a campaign in East Asia around setting a living wage in the clothing industry. So again, this same language is picking up the same problems of subcontracted wages and people not earning enough to live, and the living wage being a solution. So I don't know if that answered it, but it's already international in that way.
Historically, you could also say that in the 1910s, 1920s, for instance, textile unions tried to raise the wages of Indian textile workers, for instance. I mean, partly for quite self-interested reasons, but trying to establish the principle of a standard wage. And of course, it operated in things like the Seamen's Union, which was attempted to be an international trade union. So all these things were sort of tried in the sort of 1890, 1920 period, although I don't think they had a great deal of success.
I would like to encourage us to continue the conversation over free drinks in the Marquee next. So if we could thank Jane and Gareth for their excellent talk.